All the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, it trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And always see how great is our God. Age to age it stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end. Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, Lion and the Lamb, Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God?
So he is a great God, and that's the thing that we've had this morning. Is really, we've had songs that have magnified him. That's what Psalm 145 is about, that we've been doing. That we've got the things. And you may have noticed that one of the verses that they did in the Sunday school was Psalm 145, verse 9. And so that was good. Good to have that register with us. Today, I'm going to dissect a verse. And if you turn with me to Isaiah 26, verse 3. We're going to really look at this very closely. I've gone into the Hebrew and I've gone into the meanings of the words in Hebrew, because sometimes we can look at a verse and just take it in ourselves, but then when we look closely at it, it's got something which is so rich with us. We need to, the Word of God is like a gold mine, and it takes effort to get gold out sometimes. It takes effort to get coal out of the ground. But we're going to read The Isaiah 26, verse 3 says, "Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusts in you." Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusts in you. Easy memory verse, isn't it? It's something that we can hold on to, but we know that the promise is very real. God will keep us in that perfect peace. Now, how would you look at peace? What would you like to have as peace? Peace in the world, would you? What would be definition? Because there are some people in the end days who are going to say, they'll be crying, peace, peace, because they'll see somebody that comes along with a solution to the world's problems. And they'll cry out, peace, peace. And then Jesus says, that is when the end will come. So what is the peace? What is perfect peace? What is perfect peace? We know that the word there is peace in the Hebrew is shalom. We know that. But the word here is shalom, shalom. So what are you saying?
Double peace.
A double peace. It's a perfect peace. It's a complete peace. Shalom, shalom. Now, I don't know. If you could wish shalom, 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 that would be a really good blessing you could give. And it would be something they get. But so many people are looking for peace. What's the sort of peace that people are looking at? Financial peace? You know, no worries with bills. No peace. With that relationship peace. Peace between husband and wife and brothers and sisters and those who that will keep you in perfect. Is that the sort of peace that we're looking for? We know that my peace I give to you. Michael, what's the type of peace that Jesus is giving? You know, it's a good thing to concentrate. What is the true peace that individuals and Christians are looking for? You know, that's a challenge today. In a world that wants to impinge on every level. Mm-hmm. We got arrows thrown at us yesterday.
Not literally. Oh, yes.
But it's a pace. It's like there's a something comes from the Word of God when they use words that are quoted, but they don't want to discuss, they don't want to talk. Mm-hmm. We had some that did want to talk. So, a couple there that was so wonderful. They said, "Look, just stand, tell the truth, and we're for you." That's encouraging, but we don't get that very often along the way. We get other Christians come up along the way. Say, Karen come up and her five times in the country times this week.
Yeah.
And,
so
from her perspective, it's the peace that comes from having that support. That will keep him in perfect peace. So shalom, shalom. That's where God is saying, I'll keep you in that perfect peace. That complete peace. A complete peace is not just the segments that we have in our lives, you know, where you can get unsettled and not peaceful. You can be worrying, it's sort of like a point where you've lost your peace. It says, you know, you've lost that place where you can shelter in the arms of God. You know, it's great to be able to sing the songs, but it's another thing to live them out, isn't it? You know, how great is our God? And we can sing it. And he is great. We know that. But he is great within our situation. Mm-hmm. He's great within the situations that we face. He's saying, if you really do believe that I'm great, then don't worry. Don't worry. Don't be anxious. Because if you really are in that place where you're frightened of this and frightened of that, you know, there are people that are walking around today in fear. And the more well known you are, the more attached you will get if you're not in Christ. You've got to get that settled as to where, as Missy said, your foundation must be in Christ. That song we sang that five verses of, I reckon we should sing that for a. We've got to get these truths, not just sung, but lived. They are precious, precious words that have been written 400 years ago and still able to feed us today. But see, that's it. It's like there are so many areas here that will keep him. I went to perfect peace first, but the keep, keep is the word for guard and protect. In other words, God's committed to guard and protect us in perfect peace. I don't know about you, but if you've got a fortress around you, and some of those things. See, where this came in, and you've got to look at the context of it, because Isaiah 26, Isaiah is telling them that they're going to be taken off into captivity. They have rebelled against God. They have buried, they have burned and offered up the children in the valley of Hinnom. And God said, enough is enough. I'm going to send you off for 70 years into Babylon. 70 years they were going. Now, this is before they were sent. Now, can you imagine? You've got a nice, comfortable home there. You're nicely living. You've got everything like we are now. Nicely comfortable and set up. But they were going to be uprooted. They were going to be taken off to Babylon. They were going to be out of their whole sort of familiar context. No churches to go to. No synagogues. No temple. They were in that place where they were totally stripped of everything. 70 years because of what they had done, they rebelled. Now, this is the word that was given to them so that when they would be over there, they would be. So they have to rely on God, not on what they had now, not on what their expectations were of expecting what the people in Jerusalem would be able to do for them, or the government, or anything else. They would have everything taken away from them, and they would be taken off into captivity. And we know the story of Daniel, carted off into there, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, we know that. But it was a total place where what they had been taught as children was going to be critical for them. See, that not all the people were left alone by God in that sense. He didn't leave Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and Daniel alone. He didn't leave them. He was there with them in that situation. He was there to give them wisdom and knowledge, how to deal with Nebuchadnezzar, how to deal with the one that was going to be looking after them, because he was going to be trained up in Babylonian ways. Now, we've got a whole culture that is being trained up now to prepare us for a one-world government, if you like. I don't know how that's going to come about. I don't have any. I'm not going to go into that. But I'm saying is that our nation is really at that point where God is going to judge it amazingly. We have done the same as what Israel did. We deserve. If God didn't, then he would not be just, because he dealt with Israel harsher than what he's dealing with us right now. But there will come a time where he will judge how our nation has viewed marriage, how our nation has viewed the unborn, how our nation has viewed all this stuff that's going on. But God is in control, and he will judge this nation, and it will mean that we will have to go through sometimes that God, as he did with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and Daniel, would bring them close to him. We can live through those times if we're close with him. You follow what I'm saying? If it comes down to a world government that says, you know, it says in we were reading just the last, Lucy was going through Thessalonians, going through Matthew 24, 25, and it is, it's the beginning of Cyrus. We're seeing those things happen. But God will keep those things. He gave that word through Isaiah to the people of Israel back then. And this word is just relevant for us today. God will keep us in perfect peace, whose mind is there. Now, this is what I love about the Hebrew. The mind. What do you reckon the Hebrew word for mind is used mostly? It's used for imagination. Do you remember in Genesis where it says that the imaginations of people were totally against God? Genesis 6:5. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination, that's the word for mind, that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. I've got many here. Go there. As I looked at this, in Genesis 8:21, the Lord smelled a sweet savour, and the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground any more for man's sake, for the imagination of man's heart is evil. This is after the flood. The mind of man hadn't changed. You see, but this word, imagination, don't we see people with so much imagination these days? We've got this, that drift off into a world of imaginations, where their mind is continually active against God, where they say, oh, God is not real. God is just, or it's just a fairy tale. They want to imagine things. They want to imagine that science will deliver them, and it won't work. It's the imagination of man. It's the paid science. It's the science that will give the results, that people who pay enough money will give the results that the corporations want, the big pharma wants. All of these are imaginations. They want what? So, as it comes into that. So, we're up to mind. They will keep him in perfect peace. Whose mind? Whose mind? What is his mind to do? E26:3. Whose mind is stayed on thee? Whose mind is stayed firm. Now, the word stayed is the part that really got me going. Because the word stayed in the Hebrew is simply what the priests were to do with a sacrifice. They were to put their hand. The word put is the word stay. In Leviticus 1 verse 4, he shall put his hand upon his head and the burnt offering, and it shall be accepted for him to make atonement for sin. Psalm 119 verse 116, uphold me, in other words, make, keep me firm according to your word, that I may live, and let me not be ashamed of my hope. So this is really the power of the word of God. See, I saw there something which I hadn't seen before when I read this verse. I love this verse. I use it quite often over the years. Lord, if I keep my mind stayed on you, then I know I have your perfect peace. That's the way I would think. But then I thought about the word stay, and it's changed my thinking. It's enlarged my thinking in this. This is where I see the word of God is so precious, because the word of God is so powerful in that when we dig down to it, we can come up with treasures that the Holy Spirit can give us that change our lives. See, we're changed from faith to faith, glory to glory. We are changed. Now, I'm not coming up with brand new things. I want you to check out this word yourself, because it's not my thing about this. You know, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace. It's not, I trust you'll remember that verse today. I trust that I'll repeat it so much that it'll be embedded in your heart and mind, that you'll have the desire to seek out the Hebrew, to seek out what the word of what God is truly saying to us. Now, we come into this and, well, I look at it, a nation that was in rebellion against God, he gave this word to, like I said. But then I got to the point where I said, well, how in the world did Jesus fulfill this word? You know, sometimes we read this word, you know, they were keeping you in perfect peace, his mind has stayed on there. We keep it to ourselves. But then I'm looking at, well, how did Jesus do it? He had 33 years living with him. We don't know too much about what he did, but we know he had brothers and sisters. How do you get on with your brothers and sisters? How do you get on with your relations? How does that happen within the family? You know? Can he live with that? So I'm saying, Lord, I mean, he was surrounded by people like the people in the world today. The hungry, the hurt, the sick. We know what he did. He was able to meet the needs of those people. He had people try and trap him in his words. Yeah, they all try to trap you in your words, all that way. Yeah, he was not believed by some, hated by others, and he knew grief and disappointment. How did he fulfill Isaiah 26:3? You see, this is the word that was given in the Old Testament, and he knew the Old Testament. And so, what I find with this is that it's so good for us to have these words and look at how Jesus applied them to his own life. Now, Paul says to us in Philippians 2, verses 5 to 8, let this mind be in you, which is what was also in Christ Jesus. Now, do you know what Jesus thought? Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. And he explains it. Who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon himself the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in the fashion of a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Now that's only one part of it. See, Paul is encouraging us to have the way Christ thought, to have the mind of Christ. You know, to have that capacity to learn from Jesus. And he said, have this mind one toward another. If you look at that whole context of that, you can do it yourself a bit later. Philippians 2 is powerful. It's like, yeah, don't regard, you know, standing up and being in the front all the time as being a place to be looked at. He knelt down and just washed the disciples' feet. And that was something that was so people, they'd say, oh, you know, you're not there today. You're not quite with it. But how did Jesus do it? In John 5, 25 to 30, verily I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now is when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God. And they that hear shall hear. For as the Father hath life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself. And I give him authority to execute judgment. Also, because he is the Son of Man. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in the which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice, and shall come forth, they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. I can of my, this is the part that I want to emphasize in this part. I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just, because I seek not my own will, but the will of the Father that sent me. Now, so, everything that Jesus said, everything that Jesus did, everything that his thought life, the way he thought, what was in the mind of Christ, I'm not going to be able, I don't know the mind of God. It would be impossible. I was saying to Colin just the other day, we were driving back from Port Pirie, and I'm thinking, now how did God make the clouds? How did he do these things? How did he manage all this? But this is only the things that I can see. This is nothing to do what he's got in mind for humanity, for people. But he's called us to have the mind of Christ. That's what the Word of God is saying. But we learn from this that he seeks not his own will. Now, I don't know about you, but your will is tied up with what you think. If what you believe is going to affect what you think, is going to affect what you do. That lady that believed what her father said about, well, once you're dead, you're dead, type thing. Well, she'll believe that, and she'll say, well, I'm a good person. Doesn't matter whether I lied or not, I'm trying to be good. That's the sort of reason. But this is not what God is saying for us to do. We are to find out what Jesus, how Jesus would do things. Now, we get some little bit of insights from the scriptures about how he developed the mind of what God wanted him to do. In Mark 1, 35, we see he spent time with the Father. And in the morning, rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed into a solitary place and there prayed. Now, I've learned from this that, okay, your day starts. How does your day start? Get out of bed. Joyful day. When you woke up this morning, did you say, this is the day the Lord has made? I will rejoice and be glad in it. Did you say that? No. You know, that's what I'm saying. But Jesus rose up early, rising a great while before day. He went out and departed into a solitary place. Why? Why a solitary place? So he could be with the Father. So he knew what the Father wanted him to do that day. Isn't that something worthwhile for us to do? We need to hear what God wants us to do each day. Or we do our own thing. And doing our own thing is what Israel did. That's why God needed him this word. He gave him this word. You're not going to be kept in perfect peace if your mind isn't stayed in God. So that's the first thing. So you hear from him. Luke 4:42. And when it was day, he departed and went into a desert place, and the people sought him and came unto him and stayed, that he should not depart from them. Now, this is after he had a day where he'd been, people had been healed. Many people came to be healed. It, I don't know about you, but people drain. People drain. You know, you stay and talk with people for a long time. Particularly, you mentioned there today about those that would come and speak to you. Just wanted to. It drains you after a while. If you can't reach them, if you can't get through to them, and you find that there is a weariness that comes upon you, that almost you need to get into that place, a quiet place, where you can get recharged. This is what Jesus the day before had given out huge amount. People were healed, delivered, set free, and yet this is what we find in Luke 4:42. When it was day, he departed into a desert place, and the people saw him and came upon him. Now, this next one is John 6:15. After he fed the multitude. Now, I don't know about you. Have you fed 5,000 people?
No.
In a day?
No.
No, I love that part where she, this lady, you know, she's in the wheelchair. She said, God loves to use damaged goods.
Yeah.
And after a period of time, she looked after 5,000 children coming to Sunday school. That's God. Mm-hmm. That's God able to deliver.
You're going to give me a bus.
Yeah, it goes to the bus company. Mm-hmm. The guy was only one bus, one day, and one driver.
Yeah.
Ends up with enough drivers, 300 drivers. Anyway, Jesus has given out quite a lot. John 6:15. When Jesus before perceived that they had come and taken him by force to make him king, he departed into a mountain himself alone. So what I'm saying is that you have to at times just retreat as Jesus did to hear the voice of the Father. Stop all the hubbub out there. There is a world out there that wants to flood you with information, that wants to put information in your heart and the mind and tell you that this is not the way to do things. But you need to have that time with the Father. You need to have, just as Jesus did. See, that's how he had the mind, how his mind stayed in perfect peace. Now, the one thing that I also found was in Luke 24:13, the road to Emmaus, you know? Those people were very upset, very, you know, what's going on? The Messiah has died. But Jesus is walking alone, and he's able to give out. He's able to bring to them the awareness that, hey, mate, you know, you guys are really just distressed over something which has already happened victoriously, that the Father has done. Keep your ears. If you want to listen to me, you've got to listen to me, listen. You know, if you hear my voice, then you will be able to have the peace that comes. And they go back straight away after they've been tired all through that day, walking through that day. They had their time, and then they realize it was Jesus, and then they go back. Now, somehow, the Word of God invigorates you when you've got some fresh motivation to be able to do it again. And then, the second part that I find looking at this in having your mind stay on God is offer our will to God. We offer our will to God. Now, Jesus had all those things during his life. He walked hard through his life, through people that would have had so much hubbub in their noise. Now, who's it? His name was David and Joseph and Mary. He's only like that. Any good come out of Nazareth? No. No, but they're thinking that they were waiting on that. And then in the Garden of Gethsemane, we find that he is alone with the Father. He's at an extreme point where he says, Abba, Father, all things are possible unto thee. Take away this cup from me. Nevertheless, not that I will, but what you will. Now that is the key. It's not only spending time with the Father in the quietness of the moment. That's how Jesus had the mind to do what would be giving perfect peace for him. And in Romans 12, Paul tells us, I beseech you therefore, brethren, that if you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. So it says, present your body. Now go back to the word stay. The word stay, this is what I love about it, is that the priests laid their hands on that bullock that was going to be sacrificed to God. Let our high priest lay his hands on us so that we might do the will of the Father. Now if we're his, we're belonging to a different kingdom now than the kingdom of darkness. And our will is now his will. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thy will be, Lord, use our will. And you've got a choice to make. Now that takes a part in our mind that says, we live in a world, how do you sort out what the world wants you to do, what the flesh wants you to do, what the devil wants you to do? How do you sort that out? You can sort it out by very much listening to what the Father says, because his word brings life. His word tells you the things that need to happen. Because when they were over in Babylon at that time, they would have had no peace whatsoever if they hadn't only worried about where they were going to be. What's going to happen, Lord? What's going to happen? You know, we're going to a strange country. We've been captured. We've been treated badly. Now, I'm going to read a section out of Daniel 6, 8 to 12. And I'm going to bring it all together now. Something very practical that we can do. I know we can do the things where it's up to us, really, how we spend our mornings, how we spend the first part of our day, how we come back and spend time with the Father as Jesus did. We follow him. He had the mind of Christ. If we want the mind of Christ, we have to do what he did. And then we have to offer ourselves to the Father in terms of that living daily as a living sacrifice for him. But I'm going to take you back. It's very practical for us right now, for these times. Daniel 6, 8 to 12. Now, O king, establish the decree and sign the writing. Do you remember the context? He had all these people around that were jealous of Daniel. And they figured, well, we'll get the king to sign a decree that he's not the prey anymore. That it be not changed, according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which orders not. Wherefore King Darius signed this writing decree. Now when Daniel saw that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being open in his chamber toward Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day. Okay, so I don't know about you, but the Jews do that now. They do it religiously, 3 times a day, at prayers. But I'm not saying that we do. I don't get contained in that. I can pray to the Lord any time. The way is open. But 3 times a day he did, and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he did aforetime. Then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and made supplication for his God. Then they came near and spake before the king concerning the king's decree. Have you not signed the decree that every man shall ask petition of any god or man within 30 days, save our therapy, shall be cast into the den of lions? And do you know what was happening? Three times a day he would be down there praying. You know what God was saying? I'll look after you. I'll look after you. You know, this is the power of our God. Now, he would not have known what the result would be, but he would have come back to that place of realizing that there is a God here. As I've obeyed him, as I've honored him, I haven't done anything wrong. That will keep him in perfect peace. His mind has stayed on me. So he's there three times a day. He's in the presence of the Father, the God he loves, God he serves. And then God, I reckon God showed him here. Come on, mate. I reckon they're going to chuck in the lion's den. But I've got news for them. You know, it's not going to be that. Did he make? Not have said that, but he would have been, Daniel would have been trusting him. Trusting that God would look after him. God would look after him. So when he gets thrown in there, what happens? Lion's mouth, muzzle, not able to move. But also I learned something from this. I look at the actions of the people that design. And I want to bring it back to something very practical for us that we may have to use in the near future. Is there may come a time where you will not be able to sing in church. There are some places now that I'm allowed to sing in church. You may be told, well, you're not allowed to pray. We've been told that you can't pray outside an abortion clinic because it's a $10,000 fine. Well, how are they going to police it? I don't know. It doesn't bother me now. It doesn't bother me that. Because God is bigger than that. Even if this legislation goes through, it's not going to stop God from doing what he wants to do. It's as real as that. And so when it comes down to that, we have people now in some countries are spying like COVID marshals. They are spying to see whether people are conforming. There was legislation going to go through in Victoria that they would have people, just like not police, but with the same powers as police, come and spy on their neighbours to bring a charge against them and say, look, they're not conforming with the government rules. Isn't this a parallel between what's been done there? You had these people that were spying on Daniel. We had those people spying on Daniel to the extent that they said, now we're going. Now we're going to get rid of him. And we're going to be free from Daniel's favoritism that he's got with the king, with Darius. Oh, this is a good strategy we've got now. You know what the end result of that was. But I don't think Daniel would have known at that time. But thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is saved. If you're a living sacrifice, if you're a living sacrifice laid on the commitment that you have with Jesus, if you've committed your life to him, then just as he was sacrificed, and we are, and he rose from the dead, so also we can be sacrificed today. Do you think they're going to do anything less to us in these days? When they feel like they've got the power to bring everyone under the control of what the government says. But do you know that we live in Andrew's Dagestan at this time? Because that's what's happening. They're exercising their power. But we need to keep our commitment towards God. That's been the theme for the day. How great is our God? You see, people will try to sort of lessen the effectiveness of God's power to keep. Thou will keep him. Thou will guard him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee. Today, that's the key for us over this coming time. Over this coming time, we will see lockdowns. We will see people that will try to sort of say, well, no, you can't do that. And we'll have people also that will be spying on others, as they did for those leaders there that thought they could then stop that. But I give you courage today. I give you encouragement today to take this verse to heart. You can be kept in perfect peace. Shalom, shalom. Double message. Whose mind is stayed on. Because you trust him. Now, trust only comes into play when you are tested. That's when it comes into play. Bless the Lord.
Well, we're ready to go.